The views and opinions expressed by callers, guests, and hosts do not necessarily reflect those of the Black Talk Radio Network and Black Talk Media Project. Black Talk Radio is new black media for the new millennium.
You're listening to Race Treaty, WCBM, Friday, 9 p.m. Standard Time. In Race Treaty, we look at international covenants and conventions and see how they apply to the uplift of downtrodden nations and peoples. We look at CERT, in particular, International Convention to Eliminate Racism, actually they say discrimination, xenophobia, and other intolerances. So we know, as Einstein has said to us, you can't solve a problem at the consciousness that it was created, nor can you solve civil rights problems at the consciousness and level that it was created. Must go to a higher level, which is human rights, and then even beyond that, divine rights. So tonight, we are really pleased, honored to have with us Chief Herb Dancer Caesar, who dances with medicine, chief of the Turkey Clan of the Minnecock tribe of Long Island. Chief Reggie Herb Dancer Caesar was born in Queens, grew up in Queens, not far from the land of his ancestors. He's going to talk about his land and where his people are in relationship to the land and where his nation is in terms of what they are declaring and moving forward with. He is a New York State licensed healthcare professional, Sensei Reggie. Recently retired from teaching at the Swedish Institute College of Allied Health Sciences in New York City. He has studied Native American medicine and massage with a number of elders that he can share with us. Chief Reggie and his family have danced at a number of socials and powwows up and down the East Coast for all of his life. So, Chief Reggie Herb Dancer Caesar, welcome to Race Treaty.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Okay. It's great to be talking to you. Greetings to everyone. As you mentioned, I'm Chief Reggie of the Minnecock tribe of Long Island, chief of the Turkey Clan. And we're still here. Just to take and give a little bit of a background to everyone out there. Our land extended from Newtown Creek or from Flushing area all the way out to Smithtown. And we were actually the First Nations people there before first contact. So we still strive, and a number of things have happened to our nation. We're actually non-reserve. We still keep our community. We have some other people have assimilated 100%. Some people are in different stages of it. We had a number of trials and tribulations involving the American government, but we're still thriving. I am chief of the Turkey Clan. My cousin Martin is chief of the Wolf Clan. Our principal chief is Chief Osceola Townsend. As my brother Majid just, you know, we just celebrated installation of the chiefs and a holiday or a ceremony that we call Nanawa, which means the harvest is brown or the harvest is ripe. I think most people recognize it as being Thanksgiving or giving of thanks. Mm.
Yes, continue.
Yeah. So, a number of things have been happening, you know, with our tribes and with our nations. Do you have any particular questions that you'd like to talk about?
Well, for our listening audience, which they are international, you gave reference to a geographical location, and you're talking about New York State, I would
think. Yeah.
New York State. So we're talking about a people out of which is now called New York State, and that's
Actually, in the reference that we had, we would call Siwanahake, which goes back to the island of shells on the back of a turtle. Most commonly, it's called Long Island, or Turtle Island is actually what we called it, the whole area. Yeah. And the Matenakot were originally woodland people, something that people in other countries or in other places don't often realize is that there were over 700 tribes, 700 nations, and each area, the people had their own characteristics. I can only say for the Matenakot and the Montauk, who are part of the, you know, My relations are part of the Matenakot and Montauk. Also, I am part Wampanoag. That over here, we never lived in teepees. The dwellings that we lived in were longhouses or what we call wigwams with domes. We lived in villages. So that was quite different than you would be out west. Long Island is a wooded area. Plenty of fish, plenty of woods, plenty of hunting. So we hardly ever wore a lot of feathers traditionally. We're actually referred to as the skins. We mostly wore deer skins. And because traveling through the forest, you don't want to have a lot of feathers on you. You might look like one of those birds. It's not a good idea.
Not a good idea.
Not a good idea. We did have a lot of fish. And one of the things that I can tell that just two generations before me, I was born in 1951, so two generations before me, they said that, and even a generation before me, that the Matenakot, all the tribes did go out and visit each other. We're all related because each tribe has 3 to 4 clans, meaning that you can't marry within your clan. So often tribes would mix up and down. So that means that you have relatives that were actually Shinnecock, Matenakot, Montauk, all the way up to Narragansetts. And my tribe, the Matenakots and the Montaukets, would often go out to visit their relatives on Shinnecock or further out or closer in. And a typical thing that would happen, to just give you an idea of how fertile this area was, that they would send out the young kids and the women with baskets, and they'd go into the water waist high. They would take and sweep these baskets down, and the men would be building a pit inland with hot rocks. And they'd come out, and they'd empty this basket into the pit, and you'd have all kinds of lobsters and fish, and clams and oysters, that they would actually just dump them right in, and that would be like the feast for the night. So that was told to me by a number of elders, and that was a common thing that would happen. That's how much, you know, food that we had here and how plentiful things were. So you can see that's a little bit different than people might be experiencing out in the West. And, you know, as I said, we were all closely related. That's just an idea. Also, originally over here, the music was played on hand drums, rattles were used, small water drums were used by a lot of the nations, but the big powwow drums traditionally weren't used here because in the woods, in a woodland area, a big bass drum would get lost. Does that give you kind of an idea how we're a little bit different in the tribes that were way out west or midwest?
Okay. So, I would think that most people who have any knowledge of any indigenous people in Long Island would most often think of the Shinnecock, because they have a big powwow every year. People come from all over to attend that. But I don't know if too many people know about the Minnecock, Shinnecock. So, I don't know if it, in terms of size of your nation versus their nation, do you have any idea of what the size of the nation was in the past and what it is now?
I am not actually sure, to tell you the truth. I know that it was a census that one census was 250 people. We know that it has, at least doubled that amount. And being mixed in, and that really, the census were accurate and inaccurate. Unfortunately, at one time in history, it was not very good to be an Indian, meaning that traditional people were not allowed to practice their traditions or their native ways.
Yes, not too good now either. It's less worse than it was before, but it's not too good of a good time now.
It's not too good now, but it was really worse before. Before the Freedom of Religion Act, the celebration that we just had on Nanawa, which was a giving of thanks or Thanksgiving, was forbidden by law to be practiced. Just about all of our religious ceremonies were illegal to be practiced. So at a time when I grew up, people weren't really openly, when I was younger, showing that they were Native at all, for fear of having, not being able to work, not being able to shop. The government could be put upon you. It wasn't a thing that was pretty much shown. My mother's time, not many people wore Native earrings or jewelry. We always kind of known when it came to the time around Thanksgiving or giving of thanks, because we were one of the groups that celebrated that on this area. So we're always known about that time, but that's the time most of the Natives kept a real low profile. Even though programs promoting the language was actually discouraged to take and speak the language, everybody was encouraged to speak English. And as I mentioned, it wasn't encouraged to take and pursue our ceremonies. And then there was a reemergence that Chief Osceola was part of that, where our faith keeper, McWan Hawk, did a dissertation and actually came back and introduced a lot of the ceremonies that were being forgotten, things that were, weren't practiced because
I'm sorry, say that again. Who was the chief and what time did he bring back these practices? When was this?
So what happened was McWan Hawk was a faith keeper and he actually came back to our tribe and reintroduce a lot of the practices that we do now. Because all the practices were illegal, so you couldn't practice them. I must take in comment that a number of the churches would allow us to have, or some of the churches, tribal churches, would allow us to have our ceremonies after church in the church upstairs or in back of the church. But we weren't officially allowed to practice these ceremonies. So you can see with that, while there was a kind of a gray area, how many Matinicot, where are they? And it's still continuously being brought forth. And people are still, like, finding cousins at this time. Yeah. And as we go forth, you know, things have to be rediscovered. Some of the elders are still around. We're very fortunate that to learn from them. And there are different pieces that are held by different members of the tribes as we go forward. That was a lot, too. Also, people tend to forget the boarding schools, which had a very traumatic effect on all of the indigenous people, all of the Native people. You know, I can remember my mother saying that they heard of or they knew of people that went away to Indian school and disappeared. They didn't remember them coming back. So that was a very real factor, and we're in Long Island, not in the Midwest or not far away, if you know what I mean. And those things was easier not to be an Indian back in the day. On the other hand, we did have, you know, different Memorial Day parades that the Matinicots marched in that. And many of the people in Little Neck remember the family, and some of our relatives, very few of them, still live around that area. So the local people remember us.
And why is that? How come your people are not living on their traditional land? Why is that?
Oh, boy. That's a whole nother question. I can go back and tell you the stories that I know. In 1923, I believe the chief that was in charge in 1923-24 was Chief John Standing Waters, who lived to be over 100. And actually, I met him when I was younger. And he had been, the government called him and offered him a piece of land. His English was excellent. So he went there and talked with the government about this piece of land and said to them, basically, well, we don't live here. We own this land, you know, and we choose not to live here because dead people are buried here. So they weren't too happy about that, and they offered him another piece of land. And from what I've been told, you know, by the relatives, he said, we own this land also. We don't live here because you can't grow anything on this land. So the first piece of land that they offered him, that he refused to take and take it, and because he said, we're living on land, and why should we come to this place? And we do not want to live here because it's a burial site. They put a fort there, which they call Fort Totten, so we could never come back. And then the next piece of land said that we didn't want to live there. He said that you can't grow anything there. That's where the airport is. And if you know where the area around the airport, it's all swampy, and there's sandy bottom. So it's not really good for growing things, if you know what I mean. So after that, they were like, you know, you guys are so arrogant, and you don't want to take and work with us. And you have to remember that at this time, we had been forced to take and give tribute to the English and the Dutch when they took over respectively, so we gave them tribute. They came back the next year and said, well, we declare you American citizens, at which point John Waters said, that's a declaration of war, so we declare war upon you. and this was more, this was done as a political thing, but it's, you know, you can't just declare someone to be a citizen without their permission. So that led to them saying, well, you're American citizens, and we want taxes and back taxes. So the Metecon people had to pay this and back taxes, and some of them actually lost pieces of their land because of that. So you can see why people split up and just said it's easier to take and be an American. Some people actually stayed on the land. Some couldn't afford to take and keep on their land. And it was hard, you know, making a living on those areas. So the threads of people did keep the land. Some of the people kept the land. It was split up into different pieces. But those things really were some of the contributing factors to us not being able to have the same community that we had at once. We did have a longhouse. There were actually a couple of longhouses that we had where we have our community ceremonies, and over the years, again, for taxes and different things, they ended up being taken away. On the same side of that coin, for taxes, but we were really not American citizens, but we were American citizens, so there was a lot of confusion with that, and when they declared us American citizens, then we had to pay taxes and back taxes. So you can see some of the that we went through.
Yeah, and our listening audience may ask the question, upon what grounds were these edicts or these...
Good things.
I said people might ask the question, where what started this? And I would have to refer back to the papal bull in 1452, when Pope Nicholas said that he gives the Christian soldiers mission to invade, to search out, capture, vanquish, and subdue all Saracens. Not really sure who that is. Saracens and pagans whatsoever, and other enemies of Christ. So without even knowing people, they create this confrontational relationship by naming them enemies, just without any provocation. Enemies whatsoever and wheresoever placed in the kingdoms, dukedoms, principalities, dominions, and possessions, and all movable and immovable goods whatsoever held and possessed by them, and to reduce their persons to perpetual slavery. Yes, this is a religious person actually speaking in this fashion, and to apply an appropriate to himself and his successors of the kingdoms, dukedoms, counties, principalities, dominions, possessions, and goods, and to convert them to his or their own use and profit. That someone would have the audacity to speak of other people, labeling them something other than themselves, and then giving permission to their military force, their military arm, to vanquish anyone who is not of this ilk, is the highest level of ethnocentricity. And it's not just a question of thinking that you are better or you have a superior way of life, but to have the audacity and the arrogance to say that gives me permission to subjugate and to basically steal everything that you have that could be of use to me. So, 1492 was when Pope Nicholas had put forth that papal bull. It was a series of papal bulls that unleashed the Christians to the world to pillage and to maim and to, of course, commit genocide.
is it in your people's history where genocide was committed against you, or was it just a question of political attrition?
There were a number of battles and wars that actually did happen between various families and the Matinecocks. So we had that. And there was some factors that also happened, that there was land that was given to Europeans. Now, some of the Europeans married Native people, so that lessened it. But there was land that was given to them that was our land. There were all kinds of contracts that were made. So there was a lot of both, but there was another battle that the Pentecostals were involved in on faraway places as Long Island. So it was a number of things that happened. Our land was taken through the process. Deeds were made. Things disappeared. Contracts that we had with the government were not considered to be legal after a while. Remember, we were here before the forming of the United States. This is where, you know, we come from. This is our land. So that was also an issue that has to be taken into account. So land that was ours that we used forever all of a sudden ended up belonging to the provincial government. So, if you know what I mean. That was also, you know, a factor that was put into it. And one of our great chiefs, to keep the peace, actually sold off small portions of land. Now, when we look and we talk about the indigenous people and selling off land, there's also a factor that most Native people did not believe that you could sell land, but they did lease off the right to take and have a land. Just like if you were going away and you said, somebody can take and stay at my house, and then one of my relatives are coming, you know, you'll give me something to be able to use the house and stay at the house. One of my relatives is going to come along, and then you can take and just lease it off to them. So that was something that was done, which that didn't quite have an understanding, as the Europeans didn't do something like that, if you know what I mean. The Indians would say, oh, yeah. They never sold off Manhattan for that amount of, for that small amount of money. No, they leased it.
The you said Manhattan. Is that the actual name of that which people call Manhattan?
Yeah. It was called Manhattan. So they never sold it off. They leased it. And when they came back, there was a big battle. And on one hand, the thing to remember that the natives were thought of by these people that were coming as, well, the first contact, natives were thought of to be the children.
So I want to hold on, ask you to hold it right there. We're going to take a station break. We're talking to Chief Reggie Herb Dancer, and who's a chief of the Minnecock Turkey Clan, and we're going to take a break. But certainly, this is a lesson that you probably have never heard before on any radio station, airwaves, or print. So, therefore, the rarity of this certainly gives you to its importance. So, please stay with us while we take this station break.
You are tuned in to the Black Talk Radio Network. For podcasts and live program scheduling, visit us on the web at blacktalkradionetwork.com.
Good evening, welcome back. This is Bill Nigel Reed, host of Race Treaty. We are honored to have with us Chief Reggie, Herb Dancer, and who's chief of the Turkey Clan of the 10 o'clock tribe of Long Island. And our title of the program tonight is Traditional Self-Governance and Healing Historical Trauma. And those two subject matters are very much a part of this person, this chief's life. And we spent the first half hour giving some overview, some background to himself and to his people, his nation. And we didn't talk about self-governance and how does the chief, in fact, factor in the way that the Tenekot people govern themselves. Because we need to learn these things so that we can begin to experience a higher level of mental, physical, spiritual.
Hello, hello.
Yes, I'm sorry. The cat just knocked my earphones out of my ears, and everything went kaput. So that's what happened there. I've been trying to.
Just to give you an idea. Now, we must. One of the things that I, traditionally the Matinicot were Eastern woodland, and each clan was appointed traditionally by the elders, recognized by the chiefs or recognized by the clan mothers, and there was a process through the years. The clan system, we still have the clan system, but the council of elders, women elders, isn't as strong. There aren't as many as there used to be. So the structure of how we were before first contact, early first contact, as we go into, even the 20th century and now in the 21st century, there was a lot of things that had to be changed and adopted to, if you know what I mean. We were traditionally a matriarchal society. A number of the tribes in this area, and most of the Eastland woodland tribes, Eastern tribes, are matriarchal societies. The Iroquois nations, some of the nations have been able to take and keep their structures, and some it hasn't been as easy, purely because people were killed off. Elders were killed off, people were killed off, people were stolen, sold off. So the structure isn't as strong as it used to be. And now this is really the time when we're trying to take and bring things back together. Also, many people are not familiar with the Freedom of Religion Act, which we had briefly mentioned, where it was illegal for a Native person to practice their religion. One very personal, and this affects people on a very personal note. As you remember, my youngest son, Tecumseh, got married about a year ago. Well, in a very real personal story, he was out at Chinnacott talking to some of the relatives who heard about the wedding. Some came to the ceremony that we had. It was a traditional wedding. We had a chief marry him. And we also had a judge, a great friend of the family, officiate over that. And the relatives on Shinnecock said, well, because they know me, so did your father have a traditional wedding when he got married? So that would have been back in the day, let's just say more than 20 years ago. And he said, no, he didn't, because it would have been illegal. So even within my lifetime, actually it was close to 40 years now, even within my lifetime, I would have not been able to have a traditional marriage because it would have totally been illegal. Does that give you kind of like a mindset of what's happening? And it was due to the Freedom of Religion Act that allowed us to take and have traditional, you know, marriages. And it really was a lot of good people from a lot of religions that said this is ridiculous, that natives can't practice their ways, you know. And the realization that the First Nations people that came here were not indiosos, childlike, that there was, we had spirituality, we had science, we had herbology, we had astrology, you know, there were a number of things that we had, just like other places in the world. We had agriculture, we grew corns, potatoes, tomatoes, a number of things. We did forms of acupuncture. It's proven that there was brain surgery that was done. There were a number of things that were done. Bone setting, massage, wet lodges, or heat therapy, hydrotherapy. A lot of those things were done here. And it wasn't an isolated case. Medicine people had meetings that they would exchange ideas and medicines and concepts and what they were doing. But it was done in a very family-like, informal type of meeting. But those things were all considered to be primitive. They were used, and they were considered to be primitive. And we were, it's not even a matter of giving, you know, patent of them. We're just considered not to do something, not smart enough to take and do. But there were sophisticated communities and agricultural communities and civilizations all throughout the Americas when they came here. So what happened to those? You know what I mean? They didn't disappear, but they had taken receipt back under threat of being extinct and annihilated. The indigenous people have suffered a lot, and I remember talking to a group, and, you know, genocidal trauma, poverty. One of the contributing factors that I feel, you know, and there were statistics that we were talking about just the other day, with the high suicide rates that happen with Native people, and the poverty rate is like one of the unbelievable poverty rates of all the groups of people. I feel that a lot of it comes from self-worth. You know, when you're told that your people are not good enough to do anything, that your people were not worthy of anything, when, you know, people made mascots of First Nations people. There's still an unbelievable amount of our sisters and aunts and young women that disappear. Disappear, taken off the reservation, they disappear. A large amount of that, that's still happening now. And there's been all kinds of studies, you know, stuff done into what's happening to these women that are disappearing. Alcoholism. Large amount of alcoholism, you know, and not many jobs on the reservation.
Are those some of the reasons that inspired you to become a healer? I know that you're a licensed massage therapist. You studied indigenous practices of massage and body healing. What's been your path as a healer to offset this historical trauma?
Ironically, I'm a medicine man. I think it really was the Creator just pointed me in the path, and I stumbled onto it. Because I actually did not intend, I to take and be a healer, I learned some martial arts from one of the teachers that I learned. Actually, both, I learned some Chinese martial arts, and one of the things about the type of Kung Fu, Chinese martial arts, that I learned is that they did teach you injury medicine. So if you got injured during practice, because it was martial arts, the teachers would take and help you and work on you. If you hurt your shoulder or your back, whatever, they would help on you. And so being injured during practice was no reason not to come to class. And then as I studied later on, I studied for a while in Montreal, Tai Chi in Canada. And the teacher said, well, if you're going to be able to take and hit somebody, you better learn how to heal them. So there again, we learned how to use different medicines and work on injuries. Growing up, another real, real personal story was that when I was younger, I guess I wasn't too aware. I thought that everybody went to visit sick people, because every time my mother often would take me to visit people that were sick or people that were someone just had a baby. And I never realized that she was doing healing on them. She was making food for them, or doing compresses and things like that. Also, on my father's side, my grandfather's mother was part Northern Blackfoot, Martha Rosemont, and her mother was full-blood Northern Blackfoot, Bertha Rosemont. And according to the records, they were midwives. And actually, my mother knew them. And the reality of it is that they were medicine women. But back at that time, medicine women were considered to be witches, so they had to become midwives to take and be able to practice. They would. So, in one point, it was passed down to me, unbeknowing. I just thought everybody did these things. I said everybody knew these things as I was learning them. And it was really not much was said about it, because women who did healing back in the day were considered to be witches, and we all know what happened with them. But I think that, you know, over the years, that said, I never set out to say, oh, I'm going to take and study medicine. It ended up being a side consequence of something that I was doing, and I just kept on coming back to the circle. And it went from, you know, I studied Chinese herbology, I taught Asian body work, Japanese and Chinese, and it kept on coming back to the circle of working with these things and doing these things. And eventually, I ended up meeting and studying with Native American elders and teachers, and then finding out that, oh, this is very similar to, the Asian work that I did, and some things were different. And then finding out things that people knew and didn't mention or have forgotten about. If anybody knows osteopathy, and the modern founder of osteopathy and some of the first schools in here, Stiller Taylor, his grandparents had been with the Shoshone and the Pony. So any osteopath that you know can tell you about the history of osteopathy and the manipulations and massage techniques that they do. And some of it comes from Hopi, some of it comes from the Apache and different Native American tribes, and how they looked at the body and how they worked with them. But you don't really hear too much about that in medical school. How come not? But throughout the world, people are starting to take and realize that some of the indigenous methods that the people did were really the forerunners of some of the other modern medicine concepts and things that are happening. Now, as I think about it, I might be wrong, but those of you who can outlast me, frequency medicine is something that's old but new. And I think as we go further and further, we will see that more frequency medicine, people will start to use that. And what I refer to when I'm thinking about frequency medicine is everything. Sound is frequency. Smell is frequency. Vibratory waves, frequency. So, quote-unquote, holistic type of approaches, we're seeing more and more that if you have a office that people are coming into that has a relaxing sound in the background, aromatherapy that will open up their minds but will also relax them, colors, even the colors that the doctors are wearing or the people that are treating you are wearing, that's going to put you in a somewhat different state than if you have harsh colored doctors wearing like coats that are like all kinds of weird color, you know, bright colors that they can throw you back, and hard beats happening with hard walls rather than a soft type of, you're going to have a whole different feeling when you see somebody like that. So I think frequency medicine is one of the things that we'll start seeing more and more in the future. And when we look back, we see some of the things that was practiced by a number of indigenous people, not only here, was really frequency medicine. You know, singing. Was it the songs, or was it the frequency of the word that was being sung to the patients? Chanting. The world groups chanted. Did each of them know special words? They might have, or could have been special words and the frequency, how they were singing to the person. So that's just something, I hope I'm right, you know, and those that are around after me will be able to take and say, oh, we heard about frequency medicine. That's just one thought, but it's old but new. And Native American or indigenous healing practices utilize frequency medicine. The medicine man always would be singing. The medicine man might blow a whistle. The medicine man might be tapping on the body. Does that make sense to you? And how they were approaching. And that's kind of been taken out of the modern medicine, but a lot of practices are starting to take and realize that again. I know a lot of dentist offices have particular music that will be relaxing to the patient. And so that's something that the indigenous people did, not only here in the Americas, but I feel around the world that that's something that they did. Some people think it's superficial, it's like a superstition, but frequency medicine, it might be something more.
I see. Quite scientific. Chief Reggie, you were Sagamore, is that the proper title that you held prior to becoming the chief?
Ah, here we have the language thing. Sagamore, it kind of means chief, but Sagamore was chief of the Turkey clan. So we, as Native people, we didn't really follow last names, but we had clans. So your direct blood relatives would always be of the same clan. And that ensured that a certain amount of genealogical control, because people from the same clan couldn't marry someone from the same clan. You'd have to marry a different clan. And that clan would have a chief or a leader of that clan. So I'm the leader of the Turkey clan of my tribe.
And what additional responsibilities do you now assume being promoted from Sagamore to a chief? What new responsibilities are you now responsible for? And what is your vision as you occupy this position as chief?
Well, some of it is a learning on the job. we also have the the good part and the necessary part, people passing over. We have ceremonies that we do for them. New people being born, new spirits coming into the tribe, helping people to find their traditional names, teaching some of the old ways to people, counseling, talking. There's a number of things. Basically, you're a leader of your community, and one of the things that I have, and we have a big job in, is trying to do things to pull the community back together again. Also, for some people, powwows, Native music comes in and out, but for Native people, it's a way of our. This is a way of our lives. We're not playing Native music just because it's hip, because it's a thing that we like, you know, and we like it. And Native music also is not static, it's alive. An example of that is if anybody ever hears a tribe called Red and what they do with their music, you know, the DJs and what they do with their music. The Native music is alive. There's some that have made operas out of Native music, you know. Stories. And some of the Native music ends up being a little bit more like Western. Rock and roll, you know. And the number of people that traditional Native Americans that have interwoven, some you hear about, some are very famous. Some are famous, but not outside of our circles. You know, Robbie Robinson. Jimi Hendrix, Elvis Presley. So there are a number of people. And some people that haven't heard that much of, but incredible singers, incredible, Joanne Shenandoah. You know? So there are people, Cherokee. So there's a number of people that have done things played Native tunes, Native music, or Native-inspired that you might not have even thought about it. But we have a culture that is still alive because it's been suppressed for all these years. It's a matter of coming back and letting people know that they can be proud of their indigenous heritage. That's one of the things that, you know, teaching some of the old dances and old music and old songs and the ones that I know, hopefully meeting with other, you know, relations from other different tribes, nations, parts of the country, parts of the world, and sharing our thoughts, our ways of doing, and seeing how similar we are. And it's really about people of the earth. Every country had indigenous people. And while they might look different, from country to country, different characteristics, when they actually start to talk together, when you see them doing their ceremonies, when you see them eating, when you see them dancing, having fun, you'll see that there's a lot of characteristics that all of the indigenous people have. And when the medicine people sit down and talk, at first, it'll be hit and miss. But after a short while, they'll be sharing ideas. Oh, what do you do for an earache? Oh, what do you do for a backache? Oh, what do you do for this? And what do you do for this? Oh, when someone's tired, we find that this is a great thing to take and get them energized. Or when someone's tense, this is a great thing to, you know, get them energized. You know, what herbs do you use? You do like a steam, we're not doing a steam, but we call it a sweat lodge. So I, in my little practice, in my little exploration of different cultures, I've seen that there are more things that make us alike, that make us different. And in particular, when you go to indigenous people, the one thing that I've seen so far that makes really realize when you're talking to someone that's like, oh, you are definitely a relative and an indigenous person, when they smile when they touch the earth, and the respect that indigenous people have, that we're actually caressing Mother Earth as we walk upon her, as we sit down upon her, as we lie down upon her. And I've seen that from place to place to place to place. The clothes may be different, the skin color may be different, the hair may be different. When you see a medicine person, when you see just a regular indigenous person or someone from the earth, and how they feel when they sit down on the ground, or they'll take a piece of earth and they'll smell it, and you say, oh, I'm among my relatives. I know, does that make sense to you in a way?
Yes, it does. I'd like to share with the listening audience that it was just a week ago that Chief Reggie became a chief. So you're really speaking to, listening to a person who was just freshly installed in this position for his nation, for his tribe, and he's sharing with you from his heart and soul, and giving you his take on what's happening and what he plans to do. So you are privileged in terms of hearing this broadcast tonight because of who he is, the newness of his position and his vision. So we are truly delighted to have him on our show. You're listening to Race Treaty. Comes to you every Friday evening at 9 Eastern Standard Time. And our guest tonight is Chief Reggie Dances with Medicine, Chief of the Turkey Clan of the Matinapoc Tribe of Long Island. And in fact, you would have a chance to meet him in person for those of you who are close to New York or choose to take a plane tomorrow or a car ride. He will be at a powwow that's being held at the Fordham Rose Hill Campus, which is 441 East Fordham Road, Bronx, New York, 10458. That number for directions is 718-817-1000. That's 718-817-1000. That's tomorrow, that's Saturday, from 12 to about 4. And in fact, you have a chance to meet this co-host of Race Treaty. I intend to be there with him, with his son, Tecumseh, and other people who will be celebrating the powwow, and you would get a chance to meet us and others that will be there. And certainly this is just the beginning. I must invite you back, Chief Reggie. It was a delight having you. Any final words you'd like to impart to the listening audience at this time?
Final words. Well, my favorite saying, which is easy but one of the hardest things to do, and I strive to do it, as you travel along the road, remember to walk in balance. That will be my final inspiration to all of us. Life will take and push you out of balance. Everything will push you from side to side. But remember that as you travel each day, we have an example. And one of the examples that I look to is our eldest brother, the sun. That each day the sun comes up and travels a path. It doesn't change its direction. It doesn't make zigzags. It follows eventually a straight path that it follows. And no matter what your path is, you can go to the side, but remember that just the when you find your path, no matter what it is, to walk in balance and follow that path. And even if it pushes you to the side, keep going in that path. Once you find your true path, that's, you know, what you want to take and inspire to take and do that. And I hope I can do that, and this is my true path.
You're a living example of that, Chief Reggie. Thank you so much. This is Olajuwon Reed for Race Treaty, signing off. Good night.
Yeah.